Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. President, Excellencies, it's a great honor for me to take part in the opening of this year's Shanghai Forum. On a professional note, I'm honored to become a part of this impressive list of distinguished speakers in this important forum. I'm pleased that the organizers have found that the regional cooperation among the five Nordic countries, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, Sweden, and the three autonomous areas, Greenland, Faroe Islands, and Holland, which I represent here today as Secretary General of the Nordic Council of Ministers, has some relevance to the development of Asia.
The differences between the small Nordic nations and the big Asian countries are vast. But I fully agree that the Nordic experience of regional cooperation and society building could be relevant to Asia. I would like to focus my intervention on what we may learn from each other, because I believe that the potential for mutual learning is what should shape Nordic-Asian relationships today and in the future.
I'll do this by discussing some achievements and dilemmas of the Nordic regional experience, and then towards the end of my intervention, sum up with the points which I believe are the most relevant to Asia. And finally, I will mention some of the areas where you are a great inspiration to us. But before I go into this, I would like to say that also on a personal note, I'm very pleased to be here in Shanghai. This was the port of arrival of my great-grandfather when he traveled to China more than 100 years ago as a medical doctor to help people in China. And it was the port of departure for my grandmother when she left for Norway 17 years later together with her family. She was 18 at the time, and she writes in her diary from Shanghai that she deeply regretted having to leave the country of her childhood, the China and the Chinese that she loved so much. Having traveled to China on several occasions, also in the capacity of Minister of Health, visiting this hospital that my great-grandfather built, is still fully operational in Yan, Hunan, it's always a pleasure for me to be here, and I feel that important roots of my family is still here. The story of my family bears witness to the fact that Nordic and Asian people may enrich each other in different ways. But we must know each other to learn from each other. This is a basic premise for fruitful building of relationships on an individual basis, as well as between states and between regions. In his recent book, World Order, former US Secretary of State Henry Kissinger tells about his visit to China in 1971 to reestablish contact after two decades of hostility. He mentioned to the Chinese Premier, Chou Enlai, that to the American delegation, China was a land of mystery. Premier Chou Enlai replied, "You will find it not mysterious. When you have become familiar with it, it will not seem so mysterious as before." And Chou Enlai went on observing that after all, there are 900 million Chinese, and China seems perfectly normal to them. We must know each other to learn from each other. The work that Fudan University does to interact with research institutions worldwide is an important contribution to strengthening the mutual relations and mutual learning. In the Nordic Council of Ministers, we are very pleased to support this in the Nordic context by hosting the Fudan European Center at the Nordic Institute of Asian Studies, NIAS, in Copenhagen. Together, these institutions foster new East-West partnerships by conveying knowledge about the Nordic countries in Asia and by broadening knowledge about Asia in the Nordic region. I believe this is a very important work with which both regions benefit from. I understand that the name Fudan origins in the quotation "Heavenly Light shines day after day," which symbols the continuous drive for progress. I find this saying very inspirational, also for a man coming from the region of Northern Lights. Which part of the Nordic cooperation could then be of potential inspiration to Asia? The basis for the Nordic cooperation, integration and interconnectivity is our common historical, cultural and geographical heritage. In the fact that the Nordic societies are based on the same fundamental values such as democracy, trust, openness, tolerance, equality, sustainability and social welfare. Just to recap, the Nordic region ranges from Greenland in the east to the borders of Russia in the east. We're altogether 26 million inhabitants, about the size of the city of Shanghai. Together, the five Nordic countries alone constitute the world's 12th biggest economy. The Nordic cooperation is one of the oldest and most comprehensive regional partnerships in the world. It's driven by consensus. All decisions are taken unanimously. In essence, the Nordic countries are bound together by common values and the desire to learn from each other on issues where we differ. This has not always been the case, though. For the past 200 years, the Nordic countries have lived in peace with each other. But going further back, like the rest of Europe, the Nordic region was marked by recurrent strife and conflict, with shifting alliances and rulers. However, in the aftermath of the Second World War, both Nordic leaders chose to cooperate. Acknowledging that together we are stronger, these both leaders chose to focus on similarities and common interests rather than limitations, differences and fear. This led to the establishment of the Nordic Council and eventually to the Nordic Council of Ministers. A Chinese proverb says that one generation plants the trees and another gets the shade. This is true for the Nordic countries and the Nordic cooperation. Within the 10 first years of Nordic cooperation, ambitious decisions were made to create a passport-free union, a common Nordic labor market, a common market for education, and an agreement was reached on a convention on social security rights across the borders. Over the years, this close integration between Nordic countries has been a driver for economic growth and has helped balance economic fluctuations between the countries. Likewise, the Nordic students, the fact that the Nordic students may choose to study at any Nordic school or in the university promotes innovation and creativity in the whole region. Evidently, the positive economic development in the Nordic region over the past 7 years is not only due to the integrated Nordic markets. All Nordic countries have chosen to build welfare societies, balancing the market mechanism and public intervention in what is called the Nordic model, characterized by both flexible and secure labor markets, large investments in human capital, extensive work-oriented public safety nets financed by relatively high taxes, and relatively efficient public sectors. This has led to affluent and relatively equal societies. Overall, the situation in the Nordic countries can be described as a social contract, whereby citizens accept high level of taxes, not because they are particularly altruistic, but because they get something in return. In terms of free healthcare, free education, well-developed infrastructure, and secure unemployment benefits, and so on. Furthermore, over a long period, the Nordic governments have delivered relatively economic equality, low levels of corruption, and well-functioning public administrations that enjoys the legitimacy of its citizens. These are some of the ingredients in the recipe of the Nordic model. The Nordic way of organizing society has shown itself to be rational, leading to strong and innovative economies. According to the World Bank Group economy rankings, 4 out of the 5 Nordic countries are among the 10 best countries in the world when it comes to the ease of doing business ranking. Furthermore, 4 Nordic countries are in the top 10 of the Global Creativity Index. In the top 10 listing of countries with the best work-life balance, 3 are Nordic. 4 of the top 10 in the Global Gender Gap Index are Nordic countries. The World Press Freedom Index places 4 of the Nordic countries among the top 10. And finally, on the list of the world's most optimistic countries, we find 4 Nordic countries. And when you arrive at Copenhagen Airport, you can't miss the sign, the most happy country in the world. The fact is that the Nordic countries are consistently high ranking with regard to skills and competencies needed in the future. These virtues and skills are central to the Nordic way of thinking and part of the success of the Nordic model, a model which may also be an inspiration of others among them, the Asian countries. However, it's not all rosy, as it sounds like. Due to the global trends, we now find ourselves in a situation where core elements of the Nordic cooperation and fundamental elements of the Nordic model of society are challenged. Development in areas of security and economics, as well as climate change, environmental and social threats, present us with a number of dilemmas. Is it possible to maintain equality, open borders, and universal welfare states in a situation with large number of refugees and migrants? Is it possible to maintain open societies built on trust and tolerance in a situation with recurrent terrorist attacks also in this part of the world? Can we maintain economic growth in a situation where climate change may threaten our very existence? These are obvious dilemmas. But I remain an optimist. Over the years, many times, researchers and commentators have questioned the ability of this Nordic model to survive. That happened during the oil crisis in the 70s, during the economic crisis of the 80s, and during the financial crisis of the beginning of this century. But this bumblebee, you may call it, has continued to fly. So far, the Nordic model has shown resilience. The Nordic countries have proved themselves capable of reform when needed. One concrete example of this innovative response is the Nordic response to the dilemma between climate change and economic growth. You probably know the Chinese saying, when the winds of change blow, some build windbreaks, others build windmills. Well, in our part of the world, we have built windmills, both literally and in abstract terms. Through green innovation, the Nordic countries have proven that it is possible to secure economic growth and at the same time reduce carbon emissions. In fact, the Nordic countries have managed to secure prolonged and dramatic decoupling of emissions and economic growth. The Nordic Energy Cooperation contributes to stable and secure energy supplies and sustainable growth, and it helps meeting climate and environmental challenges through the growth in sustainable energy and an ever-increasing focus on energy efficiency. In fact, according to the 2015 Global 100 ranking, 5 of the 20 most sustainable companies in the world are Nordic. The demand for environmental solutions from Nordic countries have driven our companies to innovate and open the global business potential for them. I have noted with interest that green development and sharing is a part of the new 5-year plan of China. This plan also outlines the continued openness and participation in global governance and trade. This is very much in line with a positive Nordic experience. The area of energy, climate and environment is an excellent example of the Nordic countries speaking with one voice in the European and the global arena. When President Obama received the 5 Nordic heads of state in the White House 2 weeks ago, he remarked that the Nordics punch above their weight. Acting and speaking together in the international arena is one reason for this. Speaking together, we stand a better chance of being heard, achieving influence, as we have seen on the Nordic imprint of the global climate agreements and many other areas of international cooperation. In light of the Nordic countries' ability to stand together and to reform when necessary, I am also confident that the Nordic countries are ready to meet challenges that now meet the Nordic model of society. But let me, at the end here, sum up. I believe that this Nordic experience of regional cooperation may be of inspiration to Asian countries in a number of areas seeking a stronger regional cooperation and interconnectivity, focusing on commonness and similarities, acknowledging differences and seeing them as an opportunity to learn, seeking integration and interconnectivity as a means to create growth and innovation, cooperating by consensus as a very robust way of decision making, seeking innovative solutions to new challenges by working together, seeking influence in international arenas by speaking more with one voice, sharing good solutions and contributing to the development of less developed regions of the world by humanitarian and development assistance. These are some of the experience and values which we, the Nordic countries, can bring to the table in our cooperation with other regions, including Asia. I believe that we have much to offer and we have really much to learn. The ancient Chinese culture focuses on human relations from the family to the society at large, and that's coloring the whole East Asia. I'm sure that we in the Nordic region can be inspired by this Eastern humanism as well. The same goes for learning the role of education in China and East Asia. There are certainly many different reasons for your economic success and your fantastic contribution to the eradication of poverty globally. One of them is the serious characterization of your students and also the excellent institutional facilities you provide with. In our educational and research cooperation, we will seek inspiration from you. And talking about economic success, your solid and vibrant cooperation between public institutions and the private sector has produced impressive results in transformation towards green growth and your fast-growing physical and digital infrastructure. There are certainly many more areas of China's great cultural heritage. Your knowledge-based and future-oriented development and your impressive economic achievements that inspire us and that we can learn from, and therefore I look very much forward to continue and intensify our cooperation. The key word of sharing in the new five-year plan on China is really also in the spirit that drove my great-grandfather to come here to Shanghai and further on to the Hunan province of China. What he wrote as a young student is still true. We need to share what is good and beautiful because we're all brothers and sisters. Thank you very much.